there is a government party and an opposition party. The motion is placed in the House by the Prime Minister, who is also the leader of the House. The role of the opposition party is always to place constructive arguments against the bill. Today's motion before the House is, democracy is a myth. Representing the government side is Barisal Cadet College, Barisal, and is representing the opposition bench is RAJUK Uttara Model School and College, Dhaka. The government side is being represented by Abdul Toyab Akon of Barisal Cadet College, Barisal, who is the Prime Minister and the leader of the House. Nazmul Hasan is the member of the cabinet and is in charge of Ministry of Law and Parliamentary Affairs. And Shafkat Shahriar is the member of the Treasury Bench. The opposition bench is being represented by Manshia Anis of RAJUK Uttara Model School and College Dhaka, who is the leader of the opposition. Maliha Ashrabi is the deputy leader of the opposition, and Anika Tabassum Oishi is the member of the opposition party. The honorable adjudicators of this session are Hasan Mahmud Biplop, eminent debater and lawyer, Dr. P.K. Borua, ex-principal, Agrasar Girls College, Chittagong, G.M. Nizamuddin, principal and head, Oxford International School, Dhaka, Shujan Sharma, eminent debater and private service holder, Naimul Azam Khan, eminent debater and secretary, Parliamentary Standing Committee and Ministry of Education, Bangladesh National Parliament. The Honorable Speaker of the House is Mohammad Fazlul Haq, retired Wing Commander and former UNOPS Advisor. Before the House starts its proceedings, let me inform you about the order and time allocation for each debater. Prime Minister, 4 minutes. Opposition Leader, 5 minutes. Member of the Cabinet, 5 minutes. Deputy Leader of the Opposition, 5 minutes. Treasury Bench Member, 5 minutes. Opposition Member, 5 minutes. The Opposition Leader will get another 3 minutes for rebuttal, and the Prime Minister will get the last 4 minutes to wind up his party stands. All the members of the competing teams, the adjudicators, the invited guests, and other members of the audience will comprise the members of the House. I now most humbly request the Honorable Speaker to start today's proceedings. Honorable Speaker.
The motion before the House is democracy is a myth. As you know, the government party is represented by Barisal Cadet College, Barisal. On the other hand, opposition party is represented by RAJUK Uttara Model School and College, Dhaka. The proceedings now is open. I now request Prime Minister to deliver his speech.
I, the Prime Minister of People's Republic of Bangladesh, propose today the following bill. Democracy is a myth. At the very outset of my speech, let me define two of my keywords here, democracy and myth. Democracy is a form of government where all eligible citizens participate equally through elected representatives in the proposal, development, and creation of laws. It encompasses social, cultural, and economic condition that enable free and equal practice of political self-determination. And according to Oxford Dictionary, the word myth refers to something which many people believe but does not really exist. Here, one thing to be mentioned, that by the word democracy, I mean concrete democracy, which fulfills all the, by definition, fundamental conditions of democracy. So what I propose today here is the practice of pure or absolute democracy does not really exist, cannot even exist. My arguments start with the Lincoln's definition. Democracy is a government of the people, for the people, by the people. Now let's start analysis of the people. It, in simple terms, means that people are the most important while dealing with the practice of democracy. But unfortunately, this is not true in the real world. Politicians take major decisions which affect the life of the masses in the practical world. In the Parliament House, they will argue over everything except those issues which affect them directly. Next, by the people. This needs no explanation. Actually, in democracy, should be initiated by the people. But it is money that talks during the election, not the people. The votes of the suffering masses are just bought by the rich. and finally for the people. The situation here is that one person, obviously a rich one, is elected into the office, but unfortunately the real power lies in the hand of those wealthy people who gets nominated to be the ambassadors, generals, district chief executives, etc. And as soon as they get elected, to work for the people is far away. They don't even bother to think for the people. They just think of themselves. So I think Lincoln's definition itself makes it clear that democracy is a myth. And if you are not happy with Lincoln's definition, in that case, let me jump back to the first definition I made. According to that definition, democracy asks for eligible representatives. And the so-called eligible representatives are selected through elections. And here lies the problem. Most people don't know much about sociology, economics, anthropology, then political science, civic engineering, agricultural science, etc. So they are not able enough to hold a well-informed opinion about the how the state should be governed. So they make their political choices based on advertisement, campaigning, peer conformity, jit guest, and above all, how much charismatic and appealing one's marketing department can make him out to be. So democracy inevitably ends up as a rule by those who are best at marketing or advertisement. As long as people elect the person with the best posters or TV spots, you might as well sell the positions. In democracy, the game is all about getting elected, and once a man is elected, he's free to ignore any promises he made during the campaign. There is no such consequence for this failure to govern, aside from the theoretical risk of not being re-elected next time. Democracy gives free rein to petty selfishness. Most people will, at an unconscious level, vote to the person who they think will do the most for them personally. Lower their taxes, increase their employment prospects, make their health more affordable, etc. And the problem is that voting based on someone's own personal interest will often conflict with what is best for the society as a whole, especially in long term. But the political scientists, politicians, they have no other choice other than just fulfilling the selfish wants of the highest possible number of individuals who are likely to vote. These are some inevitable problems which will arise and must arise when you're going to practice democracy. The word democracy first came into being in about 450 BC. So in the last 2,450 years, it has not yet been able to be implemented perfectly. The rest of the logics behind democracy for being a myth, for being impossible to implement, will be shown by the concerned minister and the member of the Treasury Bench afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you, Prime Minister. And now I request Leader of the Opposition to deliver her speech.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker, for giving me the floor. The motion raised in today's House is, this House believes that democracy is a myth. I stand in front of you today strongly opposing the motion. In today's debate, our case stance is, democracy is the embodiment of people's will, desire, effort, and opinions. Denying democracy is like denying the desires and wills of the people. But nothing is truer than the negotiations and agreements of the people, right? So these wills and opinions of the people ought to exist. This democracy ought to exist. So these, and it most definitely, what I'm going to prove to you here is it most definitely does exist. In today's debate, our team will propose three arguments. Democracy, the best system, which I shall elucidate. My second speaker will talk about check and balance process to which the government prime minister said there isn't any provision for scrutinization of the flaws of the government in democracy, which shall be proved by my second speaker in her speech. We will also be talking about manifestation of people's wills and desires. Our third speaker shall identify the clash points in today's debate and draw an analogy between the two cases arguments. I'll be refuting some points of the Prime Minister within my constructive. As he said, I completely agree with him. Democracy, the system that is prevailing presently in today's world, is representative democracy. In representative democracy, all eligible citizens participate in the proposal, creation, and development of law, as he said, through elected public representative. This is where the clash lies, basically. Let's say a teacher enters a class and says, a class of 20 students, which subject do you want to study, physics or chemistry? 14 students raise their hands, they want to study physics. They're definitely going to teach physics in the class, right? That is elected public representative. Public, they might be ignorant, but everybody cannot be wrong. And that is the idea of elected public representative. As the Prime Minister said, as quoted by Abraham Lincoln, government of the people, by the people, for the people, that is the democratic government. It acts as a mirror reflecting people's opinions, wills, and wills. As long as people exist, democracy will perpetuate.
Yes.
What information?
Okay. May I ask you a question? What happens if most of the students doesn't like to study?
That is the idea of elected public representative. Majority, let's say one person say we do not want to do it. Do you have any alternative to the process, Prime Minister? In terms of running a country, do you actually have an alternative? I really don't think so. One more thing, name one country. A democratic country has accountability to its citizens, unlike the dictator-run regime where actions are arbitrary and despotic. after the Arab Spring, Tunisia, Libya, Egypt got out of the clutches of the vicious dictators. But unfortunately, Syria is still under the repressive regime of Bashar al-Assad. So before you raise your voice against democracy, take a glance at Syria and then infer. Democracy is not just a fairy tale, it is a reality check. Government has to play a pivotal role in reforming the lives of their citizens and make sure that they do not create aberration to the rule. If the government is found flawed, the government will be abdicated. That is the beauty of the citizens, acting as the sovereign invisible power evidently running the country. Thus, democracy exists. Having all that said, I earnestly hope that, Honourable Speaker, you could comprehend our point of view and confer with us that democracy is not a myth, rather it's an authentic reality. Thank you, Honourable Speaker. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Leader of the Opposition. Now I request Member of the Cabinet to deliver his speech.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker, for giving me the floor in this session of Parliament. I have been listening to my opposition leader being spellbound for the last few minutes. It seems to me that my dear opposition leader was very much busy with recalling his sweet memories while another Prime Minister raised the bill in this session of Parliament. From the very beginning, we are asserting that we have no headache with the governmental system democracy. Rather, we are arguing the predicaments that we face while implementing democracy. Now, for your better understanding, some of them are as follows. Number one, quantity rather than quality. Democracy lays emphasis on quantity as opposed to quality. Every person, whether equal, is treated equal, whether stupid or genius, while inequality is a common biological phenomenon. Again, this system gives birth to two classes, majority and minority, where minority is always bound to accept the majority, doesn't matter whether they are logical or not. For this very reason, famous political scientist Marvin Sinking once said, democracy is two wolves and the lamb voting on what to eat for dinner. Then my next point is inefficiency. By definition, democracy demands efficient leaders to run the government. But what do you think, my dear opposition leader, in a country like Bangladesh, where 40% of the people don't even how to write their names, and 20% of the rest know only to... enough to produce efficient leaders?
You call democracy a myth basing only on the democracy of Bangladesh?
Actually, I have told that there are a lot of reasons. Among them, one of the reasons is regarding the situation in our country. I can show you some more reasons comparing to the other countries of the world, which are not illiterate or uneducated. Okay, I think you have got your answer. Now, let's move to the point number four, deseducation. Every voter thinks himself equal to every other voter and fit to govern. As a result, these masses are less interested in the advancement of science, art, culture, literature, etc. So democracy, by definition, encourages the voter to get uneducated, but it demands eligible representatives along with eligible citizens. So my question is that how an uneducated person can be an eligible voter? Is that possible? No, it's impossible. So is your democracy. Besides, there are some other reasons which act as a barriers for the implementation of democracy, as for example, formation of incompetent political parties, formation of government by careerists, self-seekers, opportunists, demagogues, etc. Other than this, unnecessary expenses, plutocratic attitude, failure to meet the emergencies, then complexity in running the government, etc. and so on. It might be true that democracy is possible in black and white, but these are the problems that makes it impossible to be implemented.
Can I raise up your hand?
Yes.
Sir, you're saying that there is flaws, but can you basically tell why are you telling it's a myth? They can have flaws, but how can it be a myth?
Actually, observing a system flawed doesn't mean that we have to destroy it or we have no need to take it. We are telling that these are the problems that makes it naturally impossible to be implemented completely. I think you have got your answer. Then let me have the privilege to clarify you some more points. Most of the people are unaware on the concept of economics, politics, international affairs. Thus, it would be illogical for them to choose government. It's like me knowing nothing of science but appointing the next head of Royal Society. And this is often the case in the United States of America. Many American voters supported the invasion of Iraq, but only a small person could show why it is on the map, nor did they have a clue about the geopolitics of Middle East. Then my second point is that, once again, if someone is educated, they're simply only electing government for the advancement of their own personal interest, and most of the uneducated masses are motivated by money. As a result, these huge masses are not getting the chance for practicing their free right to political self-determination, but it's a great demand of democracy. Thus, by voting, it's not the national benefit they seek, rather their personal interest. In Britain, it is quite regular that most of the public sector workers vote public sector workers party and vice versa. So, really, as the political parties bends to the voters' will, they will focus more on personal problems rather than national ones. And it's a common phenomenon and common human nature to think about own interests rather than other things, which has stood firmly against the practicing of democracy for the last 2,500 years. Lastly, throughout history, we have seen various tyrants have been elected. As for example, Adolf Hitler. Hitler was elected through legal means by the votes of these uneducated masses. Or like our country, democracy will be converted to somewhat like family dynasty. This part seems to be summary of other parts. So may I have 15 seconds, okay, please? Continue. Thank you, sir. So my dear opposition leader and members, these are the problems that will make impossible democracy to be implemented. So democracy was never ever perfectly practiced in any country of the world. Democracy is a myth, was a myth, and will be a myth for all time to come. Thank you.
Now, I request Deputy Leader of the Opposition to deliver her speech.
Presenting the opposition, I'm the second speaker of this house, would like to bring to you the viewpoint against this motion raised in today's parliament. Honorable Speaker, today's motion is democracy is a myth. Due to our strong reason, we are opposing this motion. Honorable Speaker, democracy is today, our life is dynamic, Honorable Speaker, and democracy is the most dynamic system of the governing system, Honorable Speaker. Democracy refers where people gets their right to elect the representative through election, which is well ventilated by the definition given by Abraham Lincoln. Honorable Speaker, being the second speaker, I would be highlighting among my 2 points, that is check and balance process and manifestations of people's basic rights, and how these are basically keeping the democracy alive, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, this is the only procedure where the nation is gradually going towards betterment with efficiency and by providing systematic negotiation, check and balance process, and by ensuring the rights, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, a society, life, and a nation without negotiation is blind, Honorable Speaker. We have seen in past that many autocratic rules had come to an end because of this, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, talking about my point, check and balance, I would discuss about how the government is actually scrutinized in a democratic process, which is not possible in any other governing system, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, in democratic kind of government, there is actually no possibility that any part of government remains hidden from the public, Honorable Speaker. And it creates a mutual restraint. Making of law is an example of a check and balance process. For example, when a law is made, it is passed through the legislature, and there the majority of the parliament votes for it. And again, it goes to the executive department, where the president signs it or doesn't, thinking on its validity of its validity. So actually here, again, when the law is made, so there is a provision of changing this law, Honorable Speaker. If the people protest, the law can be changed by applying for a lawsuit in the court where the judge decides if the law is valid or not. Do you get any provision of changing this law in any other kind of government, and you say that democracy doesn't exist? We are having every year, we are having election after intervention of time, Honorable Speaker, and you say we are having election and you say we don't have democracy, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, in the past we can see that in Bangladesh before 1971, at that time actually we had a mythical democracy, Honorable Speaker, because the power was in the hand of the central government, and we never got any rights, Honorable Speaker. So after the liberation war, what we got, Honorable Speaker? We got our democracy, Honorable Speaker. We fought for real democracy, and you said there is no democracy. We fought for it and we got it. Before, it was mythical democracy, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, coming on to my argument, I would like to tell that if democracy is such a process which includes negotiation, and this is why all over the world people is accepting democracy, people is coming out of tyranny, out of autocracy, and if democracy would have been a myth, then why people is going towards democracy, Honorable Speaker?
Looking for military rule instead of democracy.
This is the provision of democracy, Honorable Speaker. We can at least express our feeling, Honorable Speaker. This is the main object of democracy, that we can at least say what we feel. Honorable Speaker, if we see that regarding the rights of people needs rights to be ensured in this era, Honorable Speaker, democracy, last second?
Last minute.
Okay, sir. Since democracy has a provision for speaking for our...
15 seconds.
Since democracy has a provision to express our feeling, people love democracy, and that's why all over the world, people is adopting democracy on the speaker. Human rights, women rights, aboriginal rights, the tribal rights. Now we ensure the tribal rights, honorable speaker.
No. Member of the Treasury Bench, deliver his speech.
Thank you, honorable speaker, for giving me the floor in today's session of parliament. So far, hearing the long charging speeches of my opposition's first two speakers, what I have found is that they are still not concerned about the proposed bill of today's session. Not only that, I am sure that the third speaker will also come and say that government, democracy is the best form of government. Okay, let me clear for everyone one thing, that my Prime Minister and Concerned Minister have already made it clear that there is no debate on whether democracy is the best form of government or not. But today's debate is about whether it is possible to implement pure democracy or not. First two speakers gave example of many countries which follow democracy, but unfortunately what they practice in the name of democracy is not pure. During implementation of all the rules of a democratic form of government, such type of lackings are found which had neither yet been nor which can be eradicated. You cited the example of USA, which is told to be the powerhouse of the world when it comes to the issue of democracy. You'll be surprised to know that 5% of the total population of USA owns 60% of the national wealth, making it the most unequal and imbalanced society in the whole world. Another statistic shows that in the year 2008, about $2 billion were used only for the campaigning of presidential election. Is this democracy? After all this, if you still say that democracy has been established perfectly in the USA, even then I have absolutely no problem, because I still have a lot more logics to show you. It is known to us that the birthplace of democracy is in ancient Greece, and it is also not unknown that Aristotle is one of the greatest political scientists of the world. According to him, democracy arose from men thinking that if they are equal in any respect, they are equal in all respects, and it is the greatest inequality to try to make unequal things equal. Just think about your so-called democratic country USA, where 12% of the total population are black. There, surprisingly, the percentage of black people in the jails of USA is 50%. If this is the condition of democracy in the ideal democratic country, then what will be the condition in the less democratic countries is simply your opinion. I urge upon you to show us a single country which follows true democracy. Another great inefficiency in the implementation of democracy is the socioeconomic instability. Let's analyze how much democratic your so-called democratic countries are in terms of the definition. According to it, it produces a government which is responsive to the needs of the people. Being responsive is far away. After being elected, Vladimir Putin tried to essentially dismantle his country's democracy. Up next, it promotes equality among citizens in all respects. Just see the condition of our neighboring country, India, where there is still discrimination between the Hindus and the Muslims. United States of America, where there is still discrimination between the black and whites. Is it equality? Another great merit of democracy is that different group of people can live with another peacefully. Just look around you and you will find in South Africa that the black people rob the white people almost every single day, for which the tourists are even fearful to visit that country. So, by definition, which democracy of yours talks about such discrimination? All the speakers of my opposition side have urged upon us to show or suggest an alternative system of government. But observing a system is flawed doesn't mean that it should be changed or it should be destroyed. Implementation of pure democracy is not possible, but it is possible to apply up to a certain level, which shaped countries like India, America, England as they are now. That certain level of practice has not been established in our country for the last four decades. So, to implement that practice, we and the shadow government, which is you, should work together and work out those problems which cannot be eradicated but might be reduced. So, as present government, it is my heartiest request. Stop arguing on this matter and as a shadow government, work with us so that we might lessen the flaws of democracy and make our country a beautiful and wonderful place to live in. Thank you.
And now I request member of the opposition party to deliver her speech.
Ladies and gentlemen present in the house today, a quick question. In the current era, if democracy is so unrealistic and hypothetical, then why did the Arab Spring come into being in the first place, honorable speaker? The answer is people want a government that speaks for their wills, that portray their desires, and that are actually they act according to their wills, and that very government is a democratic form of government, honorable speaker. Honorable speaker, no other form of government talks about the people, honorable speaker. An autocratic form of government or dictatorial form of government does not even talk about the people, honorable speaker. Thank you, honorable speaker, for giving me the floor in today's house. The motion raised in today's house is democracy is a myth. Honorable speaker, Me being the third speaker from the opposition team, we have just witnessed an elaborate discussion on democracy where team proposition had failingly tried to establish democracy as a hypothetical form of government in today's world, whereas on the other hand, the first and second speakers of my team had successfully established why and how democracy exists in today's world and is the best form of government for today's world, Honorable Speaker. Because there is actually no other solution for today's world, Honorable Speaker. There cannot be any other kind of government in today's world other than democracy. Honorable Speaker, democracy is the embodiment of people's wills and efforts, opinions and agreements. Denying democracy is like denying people's rights and wills, opinions and efforts, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, why? Because a society ceases to exist without the says of the people, without the wishes of the people, Honorable Speaker. So, Honorable Speaker, these agreements and negotiations do exist, and thus democracy exists. Honorable Speaker, the first clash that came out in today's debate is myth versus existing democracy. Honorable Speaker, they are calling democracy a myth because they are saying that by the definition of Aristotle or by the definition of Abraham Lincoln, democracy or pure democracy doesn't exist. Honorable Speaker, only because something has some faults, you cannot call it a myth. Honorable Speaker, by their own definition, they said myth is something that people believe in but that does not exist. But Honorable Speaker, we can see with our own eyes that democracy exists. Again, Honorable Speaker, they talked about quality versus quantity. You are talking about, in a democratic form of government, government is elected on the basis of quantity only, not on the basis of the quality. So how could you say that in a constitutional monarchy or in the rules of some kings or queens, how could you say that by inheritance, the power they're getting by inheritance, a prince who's sitting on the throne after his father is actually eligible and is actually qualified when he has nothing but except the qualification of his blood, Honorable Speaker. There is no other guarantee that he can be the eligible leader of the country. Honorable Speaker, they have talked about by the people, for the people, and of the people. A democratic government has to be by the people, for the people, and of the people. But it actually is not. Then which other form of government is actually by the people, for the people, and of the people? Honorable Speaker, which other form of government could bring a high extent of development in any country in the world, Honorable Speaker? Honorable Speaker, we don't see any country that could reach success, that could reach development without democratic form of government. Honorable Speaker, they talked about concrete democracy, they talked about pure democracy, Honorable Speaker, but that is actually not something that can exist. And last of all, Honorable Speaker, inefficiency versus efficiency. They talked about a democratic form of government is inefficient and it cannot be trusted, it cannot be said that yes, it can work for the people, it understands the people's good, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, a democratic form of government is elected by the people and they can be dethroned by the people at any time if they take any steps that are against the people. So they are afraid of that and they are bound to follow their promises, to follow their manifesto that they had given before the election, and they have to work for the people.
Now I request for the leader of the opposition for rebuttal round, and you get 3 minutes.
Thank you, Honorable Speaker, for giving me the floor again. As I said, democracy is the embodiment of people's wills, desires, opinions, and agreements. I agree that democracy has its flaws. It does have its flaws, but it does not really mean it is a myth, you know. Do you have an alternative to that? No, you don't. Democracy cannot be a myth. As I said in my first speech, it exists in every level of the world. Democracy, you said that democracy is a slow process, and I do agree with it. Democracy is a slow process, but the outcomes do come in the end. I would also like to say everything comes with its pros and cons. You cannot accept democracy to have all the good things only. It will have its cons, and still it will exist in this world. The team proposition here said U.S. has biasness towards the white people and there is discrimination towards the black people. Recently, there was this huge issue on the N-word, right? See, there is a quota. There is an affirmative action taking place in every country of the world for the discriminated group. They also spoke about Hitler being elected by the people and he happened to be a dictator. We can also see the same thing happening in Egypt. Egypt was a dictator-run regime. And it was Mohammed Morsi was put into power by the Egyptians. But when he was aberrated, from his path, from the right path, the Egyptians took action to make sure that he steps down from power. That is the beauty of democracy. That is where democracy prevails. I would also like to say they were talking about factions being tyrannized by majority. That's a basic thing they were trying to say, factions being tyrannized by majority. I'd say there's affirmative action, there's tribal quota, there's these other provisions to save the minorities. In order to save the minorities. I also spoke about Egyptians having, I have one more minute left, great. I'll be talking about that democracy does have its flaws, but it has its beauty as well. Democracy, they said democracy is a myth. Myth, really? That means it does not exist. In Bangladesh, we can see democracy existing. Democracy has provision for scrutinization of its flaws. The people can scrutinize the government. The people has provision to make sure that the government lies
you
on
have
its
to
back.
Finish.
And this is why I truly believe that democracy is not a myth, it is an authentic reality. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Leader of the Opposition. And now I invite Prime Minister to deliver his speech in rebuttal round.
Let me clarify once again, today there is no debate regarding that democracy is the best form of government or not, it is the most dynamic form of government or not, it should be replaced or not. Rather, today's debate is about it can be perfectly implemented or not. In my first speech, I said that there are 167 countries which follows democracy. But there is not a single country which practices absolute democracy. All what they do is either partial or perverted. My third speaker asked upon you to show a single country which practices pure democracy, but unfortunately, you were not able to do so. You said about some countries, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, and another member of the opposition said that in monarchy, the king or queen or their inheritance are they are able enough or eligible enough to rule the government or not. In that case, let me say why I asked you the question that what is the name of the king of Norway? The king of Norway is Fifth Harald. The king of Sweden is Carl VI Gustav, and the queen of Denmark is Second Margaret. The three of the countries you mentioned are monarchies prevailing in those countries. And you yourself are countering each other. One, you say the name of three countries where democracy is prevailing, and in these three countries, monarchy is prevailing, which is countered by another of your member of the parliament, that in which country monarchy is prevailing, it is not perfect. Democracy should be the perfect one. So, you are countering yourself. I have nothing to say. And one of you, a member of the parliament, said that absolute something is not possible. And this is what we mean. This is what we want to say, that absolute something is not possible. And you have just confessed that thing. You said that in Bangladesh, election is prevailing, so democracy is prevailing. It's not that in one country, if election prevails, democracy prevails there. Election is a characteristic of democracy. An eligible representative is a condition for democracy. It's not guaranteed that by election the eligible representative will be elected. Previously, my previous speaker said that Hitler was also elected, not he was dictator from the very start of his reign. Then you mentioned about Egypt. Let me clarify what actually is going on in Egypt. Morsi tried to establish democracy in that country. But in that country, democracy were not possible. As we say, democracy is not possible. And that is why now they're trying to establish military rule. Next, I asked you a question that what happens, you just given an example of classroom. I asked you what happens if the majority of the students doesn't want to do the class or follow the class. The fact is that democracy asks for eligible citizen. It means the person who gives vote and the person who is voted, everyone. So here students are also included in those eligible citizens. But unfortunately, they are not interested in the class. So how can you say them eligible? That is what we want to say, that when uneducated masses are giving the vote, they are not eligible to vote, but they are giving the vote, and the right of giving vote to those uneducated masses are given by your so-called democracy. Now, the question is, even democracy have so much faults, then why should we follow democracy? In that case, the thing I should say that what my third speaker said, observing a system is flawed does not mean that it should be changed. The fact is that many political scientists or many sociologists have defined democracy, and after practicing 2,500 years, it has come to its present shape. I am not a political scientist, neither I am a sociologist. I am just a politician. Today I will give you an alternative system. You will practice it for next 2,500 years, and will it go on like this? No, it's not. The fact is that in the last four decades, some person thought that democracy can be implemented perfectly. It has no flaws. So they did not take any steps. Some other people thought that democracy has some flaws. May I have 15 more seconds?
Yeah.
Democracy may have some faults, but they have no solutions, so they did not take any steps. But they did not think like that democracy may have some fault, they have some problems.
Okay, finish.
sir, please, sir. Mm-hmm. They cannot be solved, but they can be minimized. And for this reason, you, the opposition side, and we have to work together. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks to all the participants of both the parties. They have spoken well. All of them has tried their best to put up best effort. The topic was also very interesting. Democracy is a myth or not. So the government party has tried their best to prove that it is a myth. On the other hand, the opponent has tried that it is not a myth and it is an absolute function. Like some scientists said, that democracy is a function function that is out of capitalism. And democracy is a system of government and in which people are to be governed by and with the consent. That is the most important language that I have said regarding democracy. The government party has tried also to show the darkness of democracy and its practices. While the opposition party has explained that democracy is the right function of governance of individual country. Democracy will be more refined and established time goes, that democracy will be more established as we understand. But sometimes democracy is a myth, sometimes not. With this hope, I think both the parties has done well, and I must have declared the result. Before I declare the result, I must tell that the result was a very competitive result and the difference is very less. Now, the winning party is the government party, Barisal Cadet College. Thank you, Barisal Cadet College party, and thank you very much for everything.